and welcome to Aloha Authentic. I'm your host, Kamaka Pili. On today's show, we're speaking with the Daughters of Hawaii about their efforts in preserving and perpetuating Hawaiian culture. Interesting fact, there are only three royal palaces within the U.S. Iolani Palace, Queen Emma Summer Palace, and Hulihe'e Palace. Did you know? Now you do. It's my pleasure to introduce just two of the many members of Daughters of Hawaii organization. We have one of the members of the board of directors, Kehaulani Keana Aina, and we have Manu Powers, who's the regent. Thank you very much for flying all the way from Hawaii to here on Oahu.
Mahalo.
Really appreciate it. Before we get into our conversation, because we have a great show and a great conversation in front of us, we have our own protocol. Our umeke, our bowl of poi, is open on the table because, you know, Tutu used to always say, when the bowl of poi is open on the dinner table, there's no negativity spoken, only positive and words of uplifting. And that's what we're going to be getting here when we're talking about Daughters of Hawaii and the places they care about, one being Queen Emma Summer Palace. Again, thank you both to you ladies for joining us. You know, Kehaulani, I'll start with you just to give us a gist, because as a local person, we're familiar with these places, but we really don't know. We pass by here on the Pali all the time, not realizing the history that we're driving past. So share us a little bit about what Queen Emma Summer Palace really holds and entails.
Yeah, that's a good point. You could drive by on the Pali and not even know that it was here, but we are on the palace grounds of Queen Emma Summer Palace, Hanaya Kamalama, and we are the caretakers of Queen Emma Summer Palace. This was the summer home of Queen Emma, her son, and King Kamehameha IV. They used it to get away from the oppressive heat of Honolulu, and they loved it. They loved the elevation, they loved the Nu'uanu breezes, they loved the property, and this is where they chose to have their summer home. It was actually passed down to them from her uncle, who passed it down from, he acquired it for $6,000. And then...
I can only imagine how much that is today.
A lot.
In today's value.
Yeah, yeah. And actually, as it progressed to be in the hands and being the caretakers of the daughters, it was slated to be a baseball field.
Really?
Yes. It was going to be torn down. There was vines growing. You could barely see the palace. It was overgrown. And the government wanted to use it for a baseball field. So the daughter stepped in and we said, no, 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 we want to preserve and perpetuate the culture. And we have been doing that ever since.
Gosh, baseball field.
Thank goodness it wasn't.
Good thing we have the park on that side now. No baseball field, but a park nonetheless.
Shame. Yeah.
I think that would bring some, you mentioned shame. I think that kind of shows the mentality and the perspective of our culture and our land back then compared to others, such as the ladies who started Daughters of Hawaii, and compared to what we think of it today. But tell us a little bit about the origins and what really sparked Daughters of Hawaii from becoming established.
Absolutely. So the organization was founded by seven daughters of missionaries. They were incredibly prescient in the respect that they saw what was coming. They saw the diminishment of the culture, of the traditions, and the things that we hold dear and that we take for granted. I think that it was perfect timing on their part. But it was the beginning of a record of preservation and a mission of preservation in places like Hanaya Kamalama, as well as Hulihe'e Palace in Kona, the birthplace of Kaui Keoli in Keoho. These were women who wouldn't stand to see those places torn down or to be lost to history. And they set a record of preservation, perpetuation, and that is what we do today, all these many years later.
I mean, 1903, 2022, yes. This really continues. But then does the mission or the focus of Daughters of Hawaii from when it started to preserve this evolve over the time, over these past over 100 years?
At its heart, no. You know, we are still a preservation organization. And Hanaya Kamalama standing here behind you is the perfect example of that. The times change and the challenges that we're presented with change. Technology is moving on, maybe without us, but yet here we are still facing the same problems at their heart, which is to ensure that these places are here come generations from now. And we are a multi-generational organization. And that means that we have a lot of information available to us, that our membership is such an excellent resource, that we can look to the kapuna to learn how we can move forward, how they overcame these challenges, yet we can bring along their granddaughters and their great-granddaughters and have them be, you know, the keepers of the flame moving forward.
Let's talk about now. I mean, with all the guests that you have coming through here, what is your hopes that they walk away with? I mean, is it a little inspiration of who Queen Emma was, what she represents, or is it really just taking a step back in history and following in their footsteps, in a sense?
All of the above. we work very hard to preserve these palaces for the community. We preserve and we protect these palaces so that the community can walk in the footsteps of Ali'i, that they can come and feel the Nu'uanu breezes. Hanaya Kamalama is such a special place. It's open to Kama'aina, it's open to visitors alike, and we just, our main goal is to share that with everyone, so.
Lots of chicken skin moments to be had walking around these grounds.
From what?
You can feel it when you're standing down on the terrace and the breeze blows through the tree. And that tree that's standing above us right over there is so old and so beautiful. And you know that Queen Emma was standing under her branches too. And if you stop for a minute and
you
listen.
You think of it like that.
Yes, and you listen to the sounds around you and you feel the breeze. You understand why this place is where it is. But you, I'm getting the chicken skin now, but you take that with you and hopefully you then go home, share that with your family, and hopefully they come, get that feeling too, and then our mission can continue.
Thank you very much, Manu and Kehaulani, really appreciate it. Quick fact, if you don't know who Queen Emma is, Queen Emma, along with her husband, King Kamehameha IV, are known to have gone door to door to raise money to establish what is now known as the Queen's Medical Center. Stick around, coming up next, we're going to head over to Hawaii Island to learn about Hulihe'e Palace and its significance and history. That's coming up next, right here on Aloha Authentic. Welcome back to Aloha Authentic. As you see, we picked up our set, moved here to Hawaii Island in Kona with the beautiful and majestic Hulihe'e Palace standing behind us. And I'm joined once again with Manu Powers, the Regent of Daughters of Hawaii. Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming to Kona.
It's my first time here at Hulihe'e Palace, and there's so much things I know that there is to learn. So for all of us, if you don't mind, just painting a foundation to the purpose that Hulihe'e Palace once served.
Sure. So Governor Kuakini built Hulihe'e Palace as a residence. And obviously, we can see why. It's incredible here. It's hard to beat this
setting. Not too shabby.
Not too shabby. Pretty smart fella. And from there, it was passed down to Princess Ruth, of course, and then Pauahi, whom we all love so dearly. And in 1924, the Daughters of Hawaii took over stewardship of the palace. In 1927, we fought off an attempt to turn the palace into a hotel or use the grounds as a hotel. But as we know, King Kamehameha resided here in another structure, obviously, but here on these very grounds. Ahuana He'iau is right across the way. Mokuaikaua Church right behind us. So this is sacred turf, and this is something that needed preserving. So the daughters worked very hard to ensure that it stands today.
And thank you very much for doing that. But so now we know this is more of a residence, not necessarily a seat of government, but it's really ironic, as you mentioned, King Kamehameha. This was the first seat of government when it came to the Hawaiian Kingdom that he had established.
Yes.
But then we turn this way. We have Ali'i Drive, and this is the Waikiki of Kona, as it were, to be on Oahu, or yes, the Lahaina of Maui, per se. So I think compared to the other palaces, you're so unique because you're in a tourist environment.
Yes.
How does that play for Hulihe'e Palace?
Like anything, I think there's pros and cons to it, of course. Would this have been the setting that they envisioned all that time ago? Probably not. Is it difficult to reconcile the fact that this was the seat of Kamehameha the first with the hotel to my left and the stores all around us and bars and restaurants? It can sometimes be difficult, but I will say that every person that walks by, every person that walks into the palace, they're an opportunity for us to educate them, to connect them to the collection, to the palace, to our history, to the stories that we're told here or that we're telling today. And in turn, hopefully foster that connection so that they feel the calling to protect it, to preserve it, and to hopefully perpetuate those stories for generations to come.
I think that's beautiful because I always try to find some positives that lie within the negative. And I just learned this yesterday speaking to the caretaker, Ben, here, where Princess Ruth had her pili grass hut, which I thought was in a different location, but come to find out, Ali'i Drive was created and went right through where her house and her hale once was.
That's correct, right behind you, essentially. She was a woman of the people. I think her Hawaiian-ness, her connection to her legacy, to her people, I think that that was the most important thing to her. We're talking about the wealthiest person in Hawaii at the time. I don't think any of that mattered to her. She wanted to stay in the grass hut right over there, and that's where she felt most at home. I think that that's sort of the uniqueness of this particular palace, that it is meant to be of the people, that it is meant to be utilized, that it is not behind a glass wall in any respect. We open it up for community programs, for partners within the community that have like-minded intentions. In particular, we try to get as many keiki in the door as possible and as many people so that it's not the first time you've ever come to the palace, so that it feels like home, so that it occurs to you, you know, we should include the palace, we should include the Daughters of Hawaii in this and hopefully strengthen all of those initiatives.
Is it true? I mean, you can't really tell because it's plaster now, I'm told, but this is actually made of coral.
Correct. And it's some of it, yes. And so that presents unique challenges. You know, this building is very old and it's showing signs of wear, aren't we all? But she is lovely
well,
in her
speak
grandeur.
For yourself.
She is. I absolutely was. She's lovely in her grandeur, but that presents challenges when, say, a chandelier breaks or a step starts eroding. We are constantly working against the elements, whether it's the wind that's pushing my hair in my face or the salt that you can feel on your skin right now. That is something that we are constantly battling against. So not only do you have time, you have the elements. I think that most people believe that the palace is well-funded and that the state just takes care of her. But no, she's held up by donations from the public and by admissions primarily.
You know, there's some words that you mentioned that popped out at me. One was preservation, and one was a battle that you're consistently dealing with. And you mentioned the hotel that wanted to be built here. Bringing all that together, say something was built here and the palace was destroyed. What type of impact would that do to our community or to our culture and to our people?
I think it's really important to have visual reminders of who we are, where we've come from, what our history is. And I've driven down Ali'i Drive, you know, 10,000 times in my life. And each time I drive by the palace, it's a beacon here in the piko of the village to remind us of who we are and what our stories are. We, like I said, are constantly fighting those elements. And we're lucky that we have partners in the state that, you know, are advocates for us and for the building itself. But it's really important to know that the palace needs the people and the people need the palace. If we lose stuff like this, then what's that say for us as a people? What have we done? What was our kuleana and have we fulfilled it? My kuleana is to protect her and to protect her sister in Nu'uanu and of course the birthplace of Kauikeaoli in Keaho.
Well, thank you very much for all the work that you do and upholding an important kuleana as the Daughters of Hawaii.
It's our honor.
Mahalo. Stay tuned because coming up after the break, we're going to head back to Nu'uanu Queen Emma's Summer Palace to learn about the Prince Lot Hula Festival. Coming up next on Aloha Authentic. What native Hawaiian bird do these feathers come from? Is it A, o'o, B, elepaio, C, a papane, or D, io? The answer when we return. What native Hawaiian bird do these feathers come from? The answer is A, o'o. The golden feathers from the o'o bird were specially prized by Hawaiians and reserved for royalty. In 1887, Queen Kapi'olani and Princess Liliuokalani were invited to Queen Victoria's Golden Jubilee. To one of the official events, Queen Kapi'olani wore her now iconic lei hulu gown. The black dress was adorned with four long lei made with o'o feathers. Down the front of the dress were also three feathered crescents also made with o'o feathers.
The Bishop Museum cares for 6 extra crescents that were made for the dress, but were not used for its final iteration. Did you know? Now you do.
Welcome back to Aloha Authentic. We moved right back to Queen Emma Summer Palace here on Oahu, and I'm really stoked to introduce the Executive Director of the Prince Lot Hula Festival, Pauline Worsham. Thank you very much for taking the time.
Aloha Kamaka. Nice to be here.
Thank you very much for being here, because I know this is the 45th anniversary for the Prince Lot Hula Festival, and the third year, if I'm not mistaken, here at Queen Emma Summer Palace. I think it's interesting because when we think of hula festivals, we may tend to think more of a competition, but this isn't a competitive festival. Tell us a little bit about the Prince Lot Hula Festival and what really started it.
Well, the Prince Lot Hula Festival started 45 years ago to really unite the community, to bring the community together. And we've continued that tradition for 45 years. It started very small in Moanalua Gardens on the bed of a flatbed truck. And since then we've grown it to be the largest non-competitive hula festival in the islands. And what's different about the Prince Lot Hula Festival is it's all about sharing. Nalani Olds and Wendell Silva, who helped found the festival. In fact, Nalani was had the idea for the festival and helped start the festival. But they conceived it as a sharing of aloha, a sharing of hula with aloha. And over the years, we've maintained that. And, you know, it's really the people's festival. It's all about embracing our community and sharing the love of hula with the community. So we're not a competitive event. We're a non-competitive event. And I think that's what makes us so different and appealing, is that, you know, the Kumuhula love the festival because they can bring everyone, you know, from their 3-year-old keiki to their 73-year-old kupuna.
I'm sure for the dancers, it's a lot less of a anxiety for them too, that they're
right.
Not the one who messed up and that's why we didn't win.
Right, yeah. And you're absolutely right. You know, in a competitive festival, they bring their best dancers, so they can't bring everyone. And with the Prince Lot Hula Festival, they can bring everyone. And you see that joy, you know, of just of performing for the sake of sharing the hula. And that's what comes across at the Prince Lot Hula Festival.
So who is Prince Lot, and why does the festival carries his name as the festival's name?
Prince Lot Kapuaiva, who reigned as Kamehameha V, actually inherited the entire ahupua'a of Moanalua. And when he was there, he built his summer home. And when he had his pa'ina, he invited halau from the west side, because during that time, hula was underground. It was prohibited to be performed in public, and that was his way of helping to revive hula, to bring it into a public setting. And when King Kakuhihewa, who ruled in the 1600s, he occupied Kamananui, Moanalua Valley, and established it as a center of hula enchanting. So actually, Prince Lot helped continue that legacy of hula enchanting with bringing hula back to Moanalua. And so we named the festival after him in honor of his legacy, and also to continue that legacy.
Well, that's beautiful. Where is the connection between Prince Lot, Kamehameha V, and Queen Emma, you know, as the palace carries her name?
Well, Queen Emma's husband, Kamehameha IV, Liholiho, and Lot Kapuaiva, Kamehameha V, were brothers. And so, you know, we can imagine that they had many family gatherings here at Queen Emma Summer Palace. And so it made it a natural setting when we had to pivot to a virtual festival to come here to Queen Emma Summer Palace.
Well, thank you very much, Pauline. We have a little makana for you, but I just really want to say thank you for continuing such an important legacy and tradition.
Mahalo.
Mahalo. For all you folks at home, here's a little sneak peek to this year's upcoming 45th anniversary of the Prince Lot Hula Festival. Oh, Welcome back to Aloha Authentic. Thank you very much, Manu. Between you and Kehaulani, really shared a lot. And I'm hoping that we have inspired our viewers to come and visit the palaces themselves to find out more. But if they want to prepare their visits, is there a place that they could learn more about Daughters of Hawaii and these palaces?
Yeah, absolutely. First of all, it's lovely that you came to visit us. Thank you so much. A great place to start is our website, daughtersofhawaii.org. We have a full calendar of events, lots of ways to donate, to volunteer your time or your skill set, and we welcome all to do so.
Thank you very much. You know, for this episode, we do have our featured artists. This time, we're focusing on Kako Collective. Kako Collective shines a light on culturally significant subjects through illustration and lettering tutorials, promoting mental health and wellness, and made in Hawaii stationery and lifestyle products incorporating original artwork. Visit their website and social media handle to find out more. And if you aren't already doing so, be sure to follow us, Aloha Authentic, on our social media platforms as well. Until next time, again, thank you very much.
Aloha.
Aloha, ahui ho.